Good morning.
Good morning.
The peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Have a few announcements this morning. Just a reminder that after worship this morning, to lead by the side aisles and wait for an usher to escort you. They'll be starting from the back and then moving forward. In March, which is like tomorrow, on the 14th and the 21st, we will be collecting our annual offering for one great hour of sharing. We are a 5-for-5 congregation. That means that we give to all of our national cries and helps for needs for help. And the majority of the money this year, no surprise, will be going to Texas. So if you haven't been able to help in any way towards the disaster in Texas or want to be able to help, please know that the very large percentage of that one great hour sharing will be going down there to help. There was quite a surge of excitement about the Palm Sunday parade, so I've been encouraged to reenact that this year. So this is how it's going to start. We will meet at the church at 9:15, the parade going through town, waving our palms. As the triumphal entry and then going past the care center. We will return to church for worship because it's also Passion Sunday as well. So I invite you to do both. And then at 11 o'clock after worship is over, we will be having a grab-and-go meal, an Easter egg bake and a homemade cinnamon roll. And so our usual Easter meal that we get, we'll be doing that on Palm Sunday. So I encourage you to participate in that. It's a free will offering, and it's an opportunity to get that yummy annual meal that we normally get on Easter. Also, I want to let you know that the council is working at an urgent pace to get new sound and video equipment, as there's still a lot of people who are not comfortable coming into the building yet, but are watching us online. Hello there. And so that sound and video equipment, I hope we can have that set up by Easter. That'd be really nice. Janice Brandt has been in the hospital. Please keep her in your prayers. And happy birthday, Joy. Today is Joy's birthday. So we wish her a happy birthday as well. Oh, you're giving an applause. There you go. So I can invite you now to stand up and give the sign of peace to your brothers and sisters. You wave, give a heart sign, tap your heart, bow, whatever feels good. Invite God and the Holy Spirit to be with us this morning. That's what the invitation is all about. It's about inviting God to be present with us and readying and preparing ourselves to worship God, because that's what we do in this time frame, is we come together to worship and praise God. So let us pray. Oh God, you call us to set aside ourselves and to shoulder a cross. And we thank you for this burden. Shower us with love and mercy this morning, even though we do not deserve these gifts. God of our parents and grandparents, reach out to us in this unholiness we call life. Call us to faithfulness and trust. Send your Holy Spirit to be with us as we come to bow down before you. May you and all the heavenly hosts find our worship this morning pleasing unto you. Amen. Lent calls us to journey this and every day, following Jesus wherever he leads us. Lent calls us to journey to the place where God covenants with us. Lent calls us to worship together, to tell future generations the good news. Lent calls us to practice justice, to bring God's hope to all people. Lent calls us to faithful living, to trust the one who gives us life. Lent calls each of us to take up our cross, to trust the one who bears it with us. Lent calls us to journey with God. Let us worship God who walks with us in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us pray together. O God, in this holy praise, we know how weak our discipleship can be. We can spend hours in a computer, but only give you fleeting moments of our time. We can talk endlessly on our cell phones, but fall silent when it comes to sharing our fears, our worries, our hopes with you. We seek quick fixes for our problems, rather than seeking your vision and future for our lives. Forgive us. Forgive us for our lack of trust, for our faithless living, for closing our hearts to the call of Jesus. Forgive us as we may lay aside all that keeps us from you, so we may take up the life you offer to us through Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. This is the good news. God does not go back on the promises made oh so long ago. God does not reject us. God redeems us. God does not withhold love, but God pours that love into our barren lives. For you see, my friends, if you truly ask for forgiveness for your sins and desire to be in a living relationship with God and one another, then God has heard your prayers. Your sins are forgiven. We are a new people. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Thank you.
turn the camera around so people at home can see all of you doing it, because it is so lovely. I also want to remind you, too, in the back of the church, there's one for family. There are some Lenten devotional cards, and they don't go in any specific order, but I invite you to take a pack and just pull a card out each day. It gives you scripture to reflect upon and a couple of short questions, and just a short time of meditation as we are in the season of Lent. So they are on the back table, and there's one for family. So, I'd like to invite the children to stand up and wave at everybody, and everybody wave back at them. Hi guys, good to see all of you. We are so blessed to have so many children in our midst. So, I have a question for the children, and then I'm gonna ask the adults. How many of you are ready for spring and summer? Say it, are you? Yeah, okay, adults, how many of you are ready for spring and summer?
Yes!
I started to see some green irises just poking their little heads up. I'm so excited. So today, I want you to share, whether you're an adult or a child, I want you to share with the person you're with what you like to do during the spring and summer. What do you like to do? Let's dream about that. In the spring and summer. Raise your hand if you said that. How about going swimming? Yeah. How about fishing? Somebody likes to go fishing with Papa. That's wonderful. So when it gets hot outside, I know that a lot of us like to find a nice lake or a river and sit in the shade of a tree and fish. I like to grab a cup of coffee and sit under a tree and read the newspaper. And I like to go shopping, too. But sometimes I think about going shopping a lot, but I haven't been able to. I think about going shopping like this morning. But, of course, I would never go shopping on Sunday mornings. Sunday mornings, I want to be with you. I want to be with all of you so we can worship together. There's so many things to do in the spring or summer, such as fishing and swimming and camping and baseball and bike riding. There isn't enough time for everything, is there? Now, Jesus knows that we like to do things that are fun. Jesus knows we like to shop and play baseball and go fishing, and we call these things pleasures. It's a pleasure to go shopping and go swimming and fishing and play ball. Here's what Jesus said about pleasure. If you want to be my follower, you should put aside your pleasures and follow me. You see, Jesus wants us to have a good time. There's nothing wrong with enjoying our pleasures. He wants us to enjoy all the wonderful things on earth, but he also wants us to follow his teaching. Now, being a follower of Jesus is not always fun. Sometimes we have to do some things that are hard to be a follower of Jesus. To be a follower of Jesus, we sometimes have to put aside our pleasures for a while. We may have to help a friend to do some chores instead of playing ball. Being a follower of Jesus could mean giving our allowance to someone who doesn't have anything to eat instead of buying a candy bar. Following Jesus means that we must put God and other people first before we get our pleasures. Jesus always thought about his Father in heaven first, other people second, and himself third. If you want to be a follower of Jesus, you must also give up some of your pleasures and think of others first. On Sunday mornings, we lay down our baseball gloves, we park our bikes, and we put away our fishing poles. On Sunday mornings, we worship the Lord and learn more about Jesus. You know, we should stop every day, whatever we are doing, put aside our pleasures, and take some time to thank Jesus for all that we have. We can even share the way we feel with our friends and help teach them to be followers of Jesus too. So, the next time you want to go fishing or shopping or play ball, see if someone needs you before you leave. After you shared yourself with others, then you can do your own thing. That's what's called being a follower of Jesus. Will you pray with me? Let's pray. Repeat after me. Dear God, thank you for calling me to worship today. Help me to set aside my pleasures to follow you. Help me to remember that those others come second. Bless our family and friends, our church and our community, and the entire world. In Jesus' name, amen. Let us continue our worship in a time of prayer. Let's pray. O Lord, we give you thanks for all the saints who have gone before us, for those who waited in patience for your promise to come to pass, for those who lived in hope while around them it seemed to be only darkness, for those who witnessed to you when it was not considered the proper thing to do, for those who forgot their own selves and their desire to obey your commands and respond to your calls upon their lives. Help us today, O God, to examine the level of our faith, to look seriously at our resistance, to talk about the cross and about sacrifice, and to consider in prayer our reluctance to give up the things of this world, to risk our reputations, our comfort, and our security for the sake of following you, for the sake of witnessing to you, for the sake of obeying you. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray, O Lord, that you would make us bold in our faith by our self-forgetting, our self-denial. Help us make visible to all our brothers and sisters the reality of your power and care, the power and care that is so often made evident when we confess our weakness, and so often concealed from others when we are strong. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray, O Lord, for those people whose names or faces or needs are resting upon our hearts, for the members of our church family whose health is failing as they age, for those believers whose families are struggling to deal with teenage rebellion and adult confusion and uncertainty, for those who have little or no faith and who seem to be lost even though your light shines around them and your word is so close to hand, let us pray for them now. All these things we pray to you through your Son, Jesus, who died that we might live, and who lives that we might never die. And now let us join our voices and pray the words that Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Sarah, Jake, Levi, and Dax to please arise and mend this gathered body of Christians so that they may affirm their baptisms by uniting with us in this household of faith. I'm going to have you guys stand up against the wall if you don't mind. I'm going to take a moment to turn the camera around so our friends at home can meet you as well. Welcome to our church family this morning, Bo and Sarah Baldens and their three sons, Jake, Levi, and Dax, from First United Methodist in Iowa Falls. Jake is in seventh grade. Wait, Jake, we all know who you are. He's the tallest one. Levi is in second grade, and Dax is in kindergarten. Good morning. Sarah was baptized and confirmed in the Methodist Church, and Bo was baptized and confirmed here at Zion. They were married here on September 24, 2005. Sarah is a salesperson for ABM and livestock, and Bo is the owner of the South Fork Pioneer dealership, and they both also farm. In their free time, they love supporting their boys by attending their sports activities and 4-H projects. Bo enjoys hunting and fishing, and Sarah enjoys exercising, being outdoors, and gardening. When asked why they wanted to join Zion United Church of Christ, they said, "We were married to this church. We've also built a house in this area, and so we're physically closer." And of course, Bo had been a lifelong member of this congregation. And then Sarah added, "Oh, and Jake loved Pastor Mark for being his director of play in middle school." We had a good time. Friends in Christ, we are all received into the church through the sacrament of baptism. And these people found nurture and support in the midst of the family of Christ. Through prayer and discussion, they have been led by the Holy Spirit to affirm their baptism and to claim in our presence their covenantal relationship with Christ and the members of Zion United Church of Christ. They are here for service to Jesus Christ, using the gifts and strengths which the Holy Spirit bestows. Hear now this scripture from Ephesians 2, 19 through 22 from the Message Bible. Hear then all of you these words. The kingdom of faith is now your home country. You are no longer strangers or outsiders. You belong here with as much right to the name Christian as anyone. God is building a home. He's using us all, irrespective of how we got here and what Jesus is building. He used the apostles and prophets for the foundation. Now he's using you, fitting you in brick by brick, stone by stone, with Christ Jesus as his cornerstone that holds all the parts together. We see it taking shape day after day. A holy temple built by God, all of us built into it, a temple in which God is quite at home. So I ask the five of you to respond to these affirmations by saying I do, if you agree and adhere to these questions. Bo and Sarah, Jake, Levi, and Dax, do you desire to affirm your baptism into the faith and family of Jesus Christ? Do you renounce the powers of evil and desire the freedom of new life in Christ? Do you profess Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior? And do you promise by the grace of God to be Christ's disciples, to follow in the way of our Savior, to resist oppression and evil, to show love and justice, and to witness to the work and word of Jesus Christ as best you are able, and so say, I promise with the help of God. And do you promise, according to the grace given you, to grow in the Christian faith and to be faithful members of Zion United Church of Christ, celebrating Christ's presence and furthering Christ's mission in all the world? And so say, I promise with the help of God. Will the gathered body please remain seated to affirm our faith together?
We believe in God, the eternal Spirit, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ and our Father, and to his deeds we testify. He calls the worlds into being, creates man in his own image, and sets before him the ways of life and death. He sees his holy love to save all people from aimlessness and sin. He judges men and nations by his righteous laws, declared through the prophets and apostles. In Jesus Christ, the man of Nazareth, our crucified and risen Lord, he has come to us to share our common lot, conquering sin and death, and reconciling the world to himself. He bestows upon us his Holy Spirit, creating and renewing the Church of Jesus Christ, binding in covenant faithful people of all ages, tongues, and races. He calls us into his Church to accept the cost and joy of discipleship, to be the servants in the service of others, to proclaim the gospel to all the world, and resist the powers of evil, to share in Christ's baptism and eat at his table, to join him in his passion and victory. He promises to all who trust him forgiveness of sins and fullness of grace, courage in the struggle for justice and peace, his presence in trial and rejoicing, and eternal life in his kingdom which has no end. Blessing and honor, glory and power be unto him. Amen. So by your baptism, you are made one with us in the body of Christ, the Church. Today, we rejoice in your pilgrimage of faith, which has brought you and your family to this time and this place. We give thanks for every community of faith that has been your spiritual home, and we celebrate your presence in this household of faith. So at this time, all men's family, I ask you, do you promise to participate in the life and mission of this family here at Zion United Church of Christ, coming regularly to worship, volunteering and serving with the other members here who have promised the same as it serves this community and the world? Then say, we promise with the help of God. So let us, the members of Zion United Church of Christ, express our welcome and affirm our mutual ministry in Christ.
We welcome you with joy in the common life of this church. We promise you our friendship and prayers as we share the hopes and labors of the Church of Jesus Christ. By the power of the Holy Spirit, may we continue to grow together in God's knowledge and love and be witnesses to our risen Savior.
Eternal God, we praise you for calling us to be your servant people and for gathering us into the body of Christ. We thank you for sending to us these believers, Bo, Sarah, Dax, Levi, and Joel, so that we may work together in serving the needs of others. Confirm in us the power of your covenant that we may live in your spirit, share regularly in worship, and so love each other that we may have among us the same mind which was in Christ Jesus, to whom we all be honor and glory. Amen.
Boy, this is the time I really miss having the cookies and coffee after church. So we are in the second Sunday of Lent, and our scripture this morning takes us further on the journey with Jesus as he goes to ultimately to the cross. So hear these words from Mark 8, verses 31 through 38 from the Message Bible. Jesus then began explaining things to them. He said, "It is necessary that the Son of Man proceed to an ordeal of suffering, be tried and found guilty by the elders, high priests, and religious scholars, be killed, and after 3 days rise up alive." He said this simply and clearly so they couldn't miss it. But Peter grabbed him in protest, and turning and seeing his disciples wavering, wondering what to believe, Jesus confronted Peter. He said, "Peter, get out of my way. Satan, get lost. You have no idea how God works." So calling the crowd to join his disciples, he said, "Anyone who intends to come with me has to let me lead. You're not in the driver's seat. I am. Don't run from suffering. Embrace it. Follow me and I'll show you how. Self-help is no help at all. Self-sacrifice is the way, my way, to saving yourself, your true self. What good would it do to get everything you want and lose you, the real you? What could you ever trade your soul for? If any of you are embarrassed over me and the way I'm leading you when you get around your fickle and unfocused friends, know that you will even be a greater embarrassment to the Son of Man when he arrives in all the splendor of God, his Father, with an army of holy angels." Thus ends the reading. Thanks be to God. Our scripture this morning assumes that there is much more to this life than material things, that there is indeed a spiritual side to our universe. Do you remember Madonna's song about being a material girl in a material world? I heard her interviewed once that this song is the song that she regretted the most for recording. But let's face it, many people do live their lives as if this is only a material world. Not long after Jesus taught about gaining the world and forfeiting one's soul, there lived a man named Nero. You've heard his name before, as in Nero fiddled while Rome burned. Now, that may be considered to be a myth or fake news, but what we do know is this, that Nero lived, he was a Roman emperor, and he lived in glorious splendor. He commanded that gorgeous porches a mile long be built around his palace. The ceiling of his banquet hall was equipped at great expense with hidden showers that lightly sprayed perfume upon all who came to visit him. His crown was worth $500,000 by those day standards. And his mules, they were shod with silver. Whenever he traveled, 1,000 chariots accompanied him. And he refused to wear the same garment twice, no matter how costly and beautiful it was. Taxing the people unmercifully, he was able to pay extravagant sums of money to anyone who could devise new methods of entertaining him. Yet with all of his riches and splendors, he was a cranky, gloomy, dissatisfied man. The immense wealth he had amassed could not satisfy his soul. And in spite of every pleasure this world could afford, Nero took his own life. It happens. People seek after wealth. They seek fame. They seek sensual pleasure. They seek every means of escape. But if they do not seek God, if they only live in a material world, they never, never attain satisfaction. King Charlemagne lived from 742 to 814 AD. He conquered most of Western Europe, including France, Switzerland, Belgium, the Netherlands, part of Italy, Germany, Austria, and Spain.
Everywhere Charlemagne's troops went, he spread education and the Christian religion. His rule unified and stabilized much of Europe, making him one of the most powerful rulers in history. Yet, in spite of all of Charlemagne's power, he arranged at his death to have his body displayed with his hand resting on our verse for today. What good is it for a man to gain the whole world, yet forfeit his soul? Charlemagne knew such an exchange was a bad bargain indeed. This is more than a material world. And we are more than material beings. We are more than being material beings. And as the philosopher Teilhard de Chardin put it so memorably, we are not human beings having a spiritual experience. We are spiritual beings having a human experience. We are spiritual beings having a human experience. In other words, we have a soul. Or better yet, we are a soul. Many have searched to find the spot in the body which they can identify as the soul. I think it's fruitless. You will find a soul in the same place that you find love, hope, peace, joy, and a host of other positive emotions. You can capture none of these emotions in a test tube, but we know they exist. Just because we cannot see love, for example, doesn't mean that it doesn't exist. We know that it exists. We've seen love in action. And just because you cannot find a physical location for the soul within our body does not mean that it does not exist. We have a soul. Some scholars would prefer to say we are a soul. Our soul is who we really are. Don't let anyone tell you that a soul doesn't exist. We were created in the image of God. That doesn't mean that God looks like us. It means that there is something divine within us. The soul is who you are. It's what makes you distinctive. You are more than a nose and a mouth and a pair of ears. You have a distinct personality. And even if we could physically eliminate all your physical characteristics, the real you would still exist. That's your soul. That's your soul. Atomic scientist Dr. Wernher von Braun once spoke these comforting words. Science tells us that nothing in nature, not even the tiniest particle, can disappear without a trace. Nature does not know extinction. All it knows is transformation. Now, if God applies this fundamental principle to the most minute and insignificant parts of the universe, doesn't it make sense to assume that he applies it also to the masterpiece of his creation, the human soul? And everything science has taught me and continues to teach me strengthens my belief in the continuity of our own spiritual existence after death. Nothing disappears without a trace. That was Dr. Wernher von Braun. My friends, this is more than a material world. We are more than simply material creatures. We have a soul that by the grace of God even survives the grave. And so Jesus says to us, take care of your soul. If your soul is all that survives you after death, you ought to take care of it. In fact, taking care of your soul, the real you, is the most important task you and I have. Think about that for a moment. Taking care of your soul, the real you, is the most important task you and I have. Take care of your soul. Take care of who you are. And may you find this season of Lent a time to reflect, to reconnect, and restore your soul with the one that gave you life. Amen and amen.
We will go in peace and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.